Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our series in which what we do, we daily discuss some questions from prelims perspective. So the name of this series is Let's Solve Some Questions for Prelims 2020. So as is clear from its name, this series is not just about solving questions, but it is also about your active participation. So we do expect that you will actively participate in the discussion in the comment box, and you will share any information, additional information if you people have, apart from the explanation that is given by us of the questions. So today is video number 23 of this discussion, and the topic that we are going to discuss today is ancient India. So let's see what are the questions based on it. So the first question is, consider the following matches of Buddhist monasteries with their locations. First, Tabo Monastery, Spiti Valley. Second, Kardang Monastery, Nubra Valley. Third, Take Monastery, Lhasa. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you friends that only one statement is correct, that is first pair is correct. So the answer is D, one only. So it is located in Tabu village of Spiti Valley, Himachal Pradesh. So it was founded in 996 CE in Tibetan year of 5 AD. So Tabu is noted for being the oldest continuously operating Buddhist enclave in both India and the Himalayas. So a large number of frescoes displayed on its walls depict tales from Buddhist pantheon. And Kardang Monastery or Gompa is a famous Drokpa lineage monastery, and is most important monastery the Lahore Valley in the Lahore Valley, India. So and now let's move on to the next question. Before moving to it, that monastery is a huge white building bedecked with prayer flags. So monastery is currently the third statement is Rumtek Monastery. Rumtek Monastery is in Sikkim. So it is currently the largest in Sikkim, and it is home to community of monks, and where they perform the rituals and practices of Karma Kagyu lineage. So a golden stupa contains the relics of 16th Karmapa, and opposite that building is a college, Karma Shri Nalanda Institute for Higher Buddhist Studies. Now let's move to the next question. Next is Bhimbetka Rock art and paintings belong to which of these periods? First, Upper Paleolithic, second, Mesolithic, third, Chalcolithic, fourth, Medieval. So we have to choose the correct answer. So most of you people will mark the earlier period. But let me tell you friends that Bhimbetka Rock art and paintings are not just limited to one period, though they are home to the oldest painting, rock paintings in India, but in subcontinent. But in subsequent time periods also the paintings were drawn. So the answer is D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. So drawings and paintings can be classified under 7 different periods, that is period 1 is Upper Paleolithic, and then Mesolithic, Chalcolithic, Early Historic and Medieval. So these are basically the periods. So Upper Paleolithic are just linear representations in green and dark red of huge figures of animals such as bison, tigers and rhinoceroses. So then comes your Mesolithic. It is comparatively small in size, and the stylized figures in this group show linear decorations on the body. In addition to animals, there are human figures and hunting scenes. So period 3 is basically Chalcolithic, and then Early Historic, and then Medieval. So more details you can check by pausing the video. Now let's move to the next question. Next is third, the origins of Anekantavada can be traced back to the teachings of Mahavira. So what is Anekantavada? What does it mean? A, human beings cross many lives in the universal flux. B is no single point of view is the complete truth. And C is principle of karma binds all mortal beings. D, multiple ways towards salvation lead to nowhere. So friends, the answer is B, that is no single point of view is the complete truth. So the this origin of Anekantavada can be traced back to the teachings of Mahavira. So this Jains contrast all attempts to arrogantly proclaim the sole monopoly of truth with the andhyana, that is the illusion, which can be illustrated through the parable of the blind man and an elephant. In this story, each blind man felt a different part of an elephant, for example trunk, leg, ear, etc. So all the men claimed to understand and explain the true appearance appearance of the elephant, but in fact they could only partly succeed due to their limited perspectives. So this principle is more formally stated by observing that objects are infinite in their qualities and modes of existence, so they cannot be completely grasped in all aspects and manifestations. So the human perception is finite, but the absolute truth is quite wide and it cannot be viewed from single perspective. So this is the absolute truth. So according to Jains, only the kevalis, that is who are omniscient beings, can comprehend objects in all aspects and manifestations. So others are only capable of partial knowledge. So consequently, no single specific human view can claim to represent absolute truth. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is the Shramana tradition is related to A. the path of seeking the ultimate truth, B. social service amongst the most vulnerable, C. occult practices in Tibetan region, D. martial arts taught to the princes in Gurukuls. So friends, the answer is A, that is the path of seeking the ultimate truth. Shramana were those who practiced an ascetic or strict and self-denying or lifestyle in pursuit of spiritual liberation. So they are commonly known as monks. So Shramana movement gave rise to Jainism or Buddhism, and then Shramana means literally that seeker, one who performs acts of austerity and ascetic. So the term refers to several Indian religious movements parallel to but separate from the historical Vedic religion. So the Shramana tradition includes Jainism of the 9th century BCE and the Buddhism of 6th century BCE and others such as Ajivika and Charvaka, or you may also call it Karvaka. So then Shramana movements arose in the same circles of mendicants in ancient India that led to the development of yogic practices as well as popular concepts in all major Indian religions, such as Sansara, that is the cycle of birth and death, which is a common element of every religion of India, almost every religion. And then there is a concept of moksha, that is liberation from the cycle of birth and death. So this is basically, these are the common you can also call them philosophical concepts that are in fact widely shared by different religions of India. Now let's move to the next question. Last is, which of these can be found at Ajanta caves? First, Bodhisattva images. Second, Mahaparinirvana image of Buddha. And then tales from Avarnas. So we have to choose the correct answer. So friends, let me tell you that all of these are found in Ajanta caves. Bodhisattva images are there, and then Mahaparinirvana image of Gautam Buddha is there when he left this world. And then tales from Avarnas are also there. So the themes of the paintings are the events from the life of the Buddha and the Jatkas and the Avarnas. So some paintings such as Simhala Avarna and Mahajanaka Jatka and Vidhur Pandita Jatka cover the entire wall of the cave. So other important paintings are the famous Padmapani and Vajrapani. So figures in these caves are repainted with considerable naturalism and there is no over stylization. So Avarna is name given to Buddhist literature correlating past lives virtuous deeds to subsequent life events. So Richard Solomon described them as stories usually narrated by Buddha that illustrate the workings of karma by revealing the acts of a particular individual in a previous life and the results of those actions in his or her present life. So this was all about today's 5 questions. So if your score is 5, then it is good, but if your score is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, then it is very much good. Why friends, why I'm saying this? Because at least you have learned something new. So you have seen this video, you have come across new concepts and you have learned something new and you have come across new facts as well. So you have moved ahead in your journey for the preparation. So what matters is the your direction of movement, that is your continuous and gradual movement towards your goal. So why I counted the scores, because I wanted to clarify you the reason that there must not be focus upon counting the scores, but must be on the on learning new things. So it is not important to count the scores as of now. So when your prelims is just 1 month away, then you can count on score, but certainly as of now you have to focus upon your concepts. That for example, if you don't see these videos, then certainly you will get no idea that how UPSC frames questions, how the questions are asked, and how you are required to read the syllabus, because reading is what everybody does, because reading is also done by person who has interest in a particular subject, and then also other Other persons also do reading, but you have to prepare according to the demand of the UPSC. So that's why as we cover daily this these MCQs, so I request you to daily see this video at least, so that you can learn something at the end of the day and you can feel confident when you go to bed. So then friends, other thing is that we have lot of series on our channel that in which we are covering your different books. For example, we are covering your Brief History of Modern India by Spectrum Publications, and that is the book written by Rajiv Ahir. And then we are also having that NCRT series of Geography, Polity, of Geography, Polity, History, and then Art and Culture series is also there. And then we are covering your Indian Polity by M. Lakshmikant in 60 days, and then we are also covering Indian Economy by Ramesh Singh. So in this, what we do in all these series, we give you a daily target and you get the questions, 10 MCQs from the given target. So in this, the way your syllabus is covered, so for example, say in 60 days we are covering your M. Lakshmikant, so obviously 10 MCQs daily amounts to 600 MCQs. So how this benefits you, because obviously friends, you might be aware of the fact that these books are the foundations of your preparation. So you are required to read these books, and every topper and every renowned institution recommend this book, including us also. So this ensures that your entire coverage of the syllabus is through MCQ mode, and also it brings discipline in your studies, because most of the students today, they are preparing from home. So but the issue they face is the lack of self-discipline or the streamlined strategy in their preparation. So that problem is solved by us, because here when we give you time bound targets, and then you have to cover that target, because you can only solve questions MCQs in the evening only when you complete the target of the day. So this helps in streamlining your preparation, and also problem of revising multiple book sources will also be solved, because your 600 MCQs or for example 450 MCQs will be there, and these MCQs will be such that they will be covering different aspects, so explanations will also be comprehensive. So at the end of the time, when your prelims will be very near, so at that time such type of notes help you in preparation. So you are not required to make notes. So these PDFs in which MCQs will be there and explanations will be there, you can rely on them at the last minute to revise your complete syllabus. So and then mere reading is not enough, for you must be aware of the fact that how UPSC frames questions. You must have an idea about that thing. So that only comes when you solve the questions. Without solving the questions, you can't get the idea that how UPSC frames questions, how what is to be read and how it is to be read, and how to recall things and all those things that and how to solve the question. So all that things comes with practice, and then also disciplined preparation gives you much needed self-confidence, because if you are preparing in a time-bound manner, if you are completing your syllabus in a timely manner, then it will ensure that you feel confident. And because syllabus will be covered, and obviously when syllabus is covered, you feel confident. And also now is the best time to start, because prelims is just only 6 months away. So today is in fact today is 14 December. So in fact prelims is just 5.5 months away. So if you want to join, then you are more than welcome to check the description box, because the link of all these series is given in the description box. So all the links are there of different series that we have for the purpose, and also ensure that you check the description box for the purpose of joining our Telegram channel, on which we have more than 15,000 students that follow us, and in fact they have access to various public resources that we share for the purpose of CSE preparation, and also including this discussion. The PDF of this discussion will be available on this Telegram channel. So we do invite you to join our Telegram channel, and you can join that by checking the link that is mentioned down in the description box. So do ensure that you check it. And also friends, this is all about today's video. If you like the video, if you like the questions, if you like the concept of entire things that we are covering, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So thank you friends, have a very nice day ahead.